Verdaderamente sí, dedicación, transformation of hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia, but first let's do a very quickly review of the bone cellular biology, the destruction, the formation, how it works. So we have the osteoclast expresses RANK ligand and osteoclast the RANK receptor. These two interactions leads to osteoclast activation. The osteoblast also secretes the osteoprotein. The osteoprotein binds RANK ligand and inhibits the activation of the osteoclast. Then we have that PTH increases the expression of the RANK ligand and so increases the activity of the osteoclast. When we think about PTH, we think about the osteoclastic activity, you know, soaking calcium from the bone to the bloodstream. So it's activation of the osteoclast in a paracrine manner. Estrogens. It increases the release of osteoprotein, so it decreases the activation of osteoclast, and also inhibits the cytokines produced by the lymphocytes. These cytokines activate the osteoclast, so if we inhibit the cytokines, we inhibit the osteoclast. So estrogens, this is the way how estrogens inhibit the patient to have osteoporosis in the premenopausal woman. Now, glucocorticoids produces expression of the RANK ligand and decreases expression of osteoprotein. So there are two ways that the RANK receptor now can bind to the RANK ligand, and so activation of the osteoclast, for that the avascular osteonecrosis. Now the calcium, we have 99% of the calcium in the bone. The other 1% is in the intracellular and extracellular space. You know, the disproportion is very greatly. Of the calcium that is in the extracellular space, we have 50% is in the ionized form, 40% is bound to albumin, and 10-50% is in the ions. The anions are phosphate, citrate, etc. Now, when we have alkalosis and acidosis, alkalosis, what produces? Alkalosis produces a decrease in acids. So if we have decrease in acids, we have more room, these anions have more room for calcium. So calcium binds to the citrate and phosphate, and so the patient has hypocalcemia. The patient with acidosis has increased acids. So the acid binds to the phosphate, citrate, and displaces the calcium. So the patient has hypercalcemia. Patients that are, for example, in stress, in alkalosis, anxiety, they sometimes can have signs of hypocalcemia. These signs of hypocalcemia are excitability tissue. This excitability tissue is trousseau sign, Chebostek sign. The issue is that when the patient be anxious, sometimes the patient can have numbness of the lips, for example. This is excitable tissue. But usually they will not say it. We need to ask the patient if when they have panic anxiety or things like that, they also have symptoms of hypocalcemia, and the symptom would be excitable tissue. The excitable tissue seen in hypocalcemia is due to the transmembrane voltage is -70 in the normal cell. If we have decreased calcium here, this becomes more uniformly, and because this continues to be zero, we have -50 millivolts, and the despolarization is easier to pass from -70 to whatever, from -50 to whatever, than from -70. So this tissue is going to be hyperexcitable. Now, patients with hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia, we have less charges. We have more charges, positive charges here, and this increases the transmembrane voltage. But because this is zero, then this changes for less than -90. And so this is more difficult to initiate the despolarization. Now, the signs of hypocalcemia. Hypocalcemia is hyperexcitability tissue, Chebostek sign, trousseau sign, laryngeal spasm. Patient with hypercalcemia present with hypoexcitability tissue. This hypoexcitability tissue is constipation because there is no muscle contraction. What else? Confusion, lethargy. Because of the increase in calcium, the patient can have peptic ulcer disease, nephrocalcinosis, nephrolithiasis, what else? Psychiatric psychiatric symptoms, these are the psychiatric overtones. Diabetes insipidus, these are the Crohn's. This is for increased calcium leads to nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, so polydipsia and polyuria. If the calcium deposits in the lens, there would be cataracts, so that would be a sign of hypocalcemia. Other sign of hypocalcemia is if the calcium is deposited in the basal ganglia, the patient can have Parkinson's disease, well, Parkinson-like symptoms. The causes of hypocalcemia versus hypercalcemia. The causes of hypercalcemia are, we already talked about the acidosis. Actually, I don't remember if it's acidosis or alkalosis. I just derived it as I did a few seconds ago. So, acidosis, there is something called, where in hypercalcemia? Yeah, familiar hypercalcemia, hypocalciuria, hyperparathyroidism, vitamin D intoxication, diuretics, the thiazides, increases the calcium level, the lipid levels, uric acid, and glucose. Granulomatous diseases like tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, berylliosis, coccidioidomycosis, histoplasmosis, lymphoma. What else? Decrease in magnesium. Mild decrease in magnesium leads to increase in PTH secretion. The patient with hyperparathyroidism could have primary, secondary, or tertiary. Primary is the adenoma, carcinoma, or hyperplasia of the parathyroid glands, and this leads to increased secretion in PTH, so increase in the calcium and decreased phosphate. The increase in calcium will be revealed by increase in the phosphatase alkaline enzyme. This alkaline phosphatase is the marker of the osteoblast activity that the PTH is activating the osteoblast and then the osteoclast. Remember that for bone markers of bone remodeling, the markers for bone formation are alkaline phosphatase, osteocalcin, and prepeptide of the collagen type 1. And the osteoclastic markers, the bone bone destruction, are the TRIF, the hydroxyproline, that is the byproduct of collagen, and the carbonic anhydrase that produces the acidic environment that the osteoclast needs. Now, so the patient with hyperparathyroidism present with increased alkaline phosphatase, increased cyclic AMP in the urine, and increased PTH, increased calcium. The patient in the bone can have the osteitis fibrosis quística, that are the damage of the bone due to PTH increased activity. This is cystic spaces with brown fibrous tissue, punctured hemorrhage that give the salt paper appearance in the x-ray, that we will not do x-ray to diagnose the hyperparathyroidism, and hemosiderin deposits and superior calcining. Patients with secondary hyperparathyroidism presents could be decreased calcium that leads to increased PTH and so decreased phosphate, or could have increased phosphate that leads to increased PTH and so increased calcium. This is the one that we're talking now, because the other one would produce hypocalcemia. We will talk about this in the next chart. The patient with tertiary hyperparathyroidism is a patient that has long-standing secondary hyperparathyroidism, that now the glands, at least one, have undergone hyperplasia and hypertrophy. So now there is autonomous secretion of PTH. I think this as a primary hyperparathyroidism on top of a secondary hyperparathyroidism. The surgical removal is the treatment for tertiary hyperparathyroidism, and for primary hyperparathyroidism, the primary hyperparathyroidism, the indications for surgery are age less than 50 years of age, GFR less than 60 millimeters per milliliters per minute, bone and creatinine elevation, the increase in the calcium excretion that is greater than 400 milligrams per day, or calcium levels 1 milligram per deciliter above normal, or T score less than 2.5. This is osteoporosis. We will do surgical removal of one gland if we find the adenoma or the carcinoma. One One subtype of carcinoma is seen in the inversion of the chromosome 11 that leads to that codifies for the cycline 1, the cycline 1, cycline 11 D1, and this is the mutation in PPRIA. We will remove only the gland, and we need to see the ultrasonography of the neck and this TMIR in order to localize the adenoma. And if the patient has hyperplasia, we remove three of the gland and half of the other gland. Before doing this surgery, we always need to check for vitamin D in order to know that there is no way secondary hyperparathyroidism, and we need to do this TMIR in order to localize the adenoma. Now, treatment of acute hypercalcemia is with aggressive IV fluids. If this cannot control it, then we give bisphosphonates. The bisphosphonate takes the peak effect in 2 to 3 days after the treatment, but if the patient is still in acute, we give calcitonin. Calcitonin will inhibit the osteoclastic activity and so no further soaking of calcium. The calcitonin is not given more than 48 hours because tachyphylaxis will arrive. Next, if the patient has a granulomatous diseases, that, you know, granulomatous diseases, the way in which they produce the hypercalcemia is because neutrophils and macrophages have alpha-1 hydroxylase enzyme, that this leads to activation of the vitamin D form. So, if we give prednisone will decrease the vitamin D action. So, if it's a granulomatous disease, the cause of hypercalcemia, we can give prednisone. Now, familial hypercalcemia hypocalciuria is a loose function mutation, or you can think it as there need more or higher levels of calcium to suppress the PTH secretion. So the PTH will be high, and because of that, the calcium will be high and the phosphate will be down. Now, hypocalcemia. Causes of hypocalcemia are hyperphosphatemia, what else? Chronic kidney disease. This is a secondary hyperparathyroidism. Other secondary hyperparathyroidism due to decreasing the calcium. This decreasing calcium could be, for example, vitamin D deficiency. Very severe hypomagnesemia, because this decreases the secretion of PTH. Pseudo hypoparathyroidism. Remember, this presents as Albright osteodystrophy, short stature, short fore and fifth fingers, delay in the development, and subcutaneous calcifications. The pseudo hypoparathyroidism is imprinting of the GNAS gene from the mother, is transmitted to the baby, and so there is resistance to the PTH because the alpha subunit that is codified in that gene is no longer being transcribed, that gene, and so there is no G protein functionality. So when the PTH arrives to the receptor, that is G coupled, there is no going to be effect of the PTH. And so there will be resistance to the PTH. Because there is resistance, we do not see the effect of the PTH. And so the calcium, it will be low. Actually, let me do a table. Calcium, phosphate, PTH. The calcium will be low, the phosphate will be high, and the PTH will be high. And lastly, the autosomal dominant hypocalcemia. Here, there is a gain of function mutation that leads to falsely sensing as the calcium levels were elevated. And so there will be decreasing PTH, and this will lead to decreased calcium. Decreased calcium and increased phosphate. Other drugs like phenytoin, alendronate, this is a bifosphonate, and foscarnet, that is the inhibitor of herpes RNA, DNA polymerase, and also the reverse transcriptase of HIV. This will lead to decreased calcium, increased PTH, decreased decrease phosphate. Because the PTH will inhibit this. Now, the hypoparathyroidism presents with decreased PTH, decreased calcium, and increased phosphate. The hypoparathyroidism could be congenital, like the George syndrome, failure of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches, remember, ventral wings of the third pharyngeal pouches, thymus, dorsal wings of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches, the inferior and superior parathyroid glands, respectively. The patient presents with recurrent viral and fungal infections. The velocardiofacial syndrome is cleft palate and truncus arteriosus or tetralogy of Fallot. The patient with increased phosphate will present with increased phosphate, increased PTH, and the calcium. If the phosphate is very, very high, that binds to the calcium will be low. But if the phosphate is not enough to bind to the calcium, then because of the increase in PTH, we will have increased calcium. This will be a cause of hypercalcemia. But here we're talking about hypocalcemia. Chronic kidney disease produces decreased calcium, increased phosphate, and increase in the PTH. Vitamin D deficiencies, secondary hyperparathyroidism, this produces decreased calcium, decreased phosphate, and increased PTH. The magnesium, this is decreased PTH, decreased calcium, and increased phosphate. Now, if we have just the laboratories exam and we see phosphate, calcium, PTH, some of the disorders can look the same, even though the clinical history would be different. But if we only see the laboratories, we need to know that there are some transforms that look the same. So we know that pseudohypoparathyroidism looks the same as chronic kidney disease. Look, phosphate and PTH go up and calcium goes down. And also the same as, which one? Hyperphosphatemia. When the hyperphosphatemia is enough to bind to the calcium. Now, patients with autosomal dominant hypocalcemia, those present the same as hypoparathyroidism. Patient with autosomal dominant hypocalcemia. And also as decreased, very severe hypomagnesemia. And patients with vitamin D deficiency, this is a secondary hyperparathyroidism not due to chronic kidney disease, present as the same as could be also a secondary hyperparathyroidism of drug medications that leads to hypocalcemia. The treatment of hypocalcemia is giving calcitriol. If it is severe, it's intravenous. If it is mild, if it is oral. So we have causes of hypocalcemia and hypercalcemia. Hypercalcemia present with stone, bones, thrones, psychiatric overtones. Hypocalcemia present with hyperexcitability tissue, like the Chebotek sign, Trousseau sign. The patient with hypocalcemia, the treatment is just calcitriol. The patient with hypercalcemia would be in acute, severe emergency, we need to be given fluids first, then bisphosphonate, and if that is not curable, calcitonin.